I'm Emily Jang in San Francisco, and this is Bloomberg Technology. Coming up in the next hour, House leaders recommend sweeping reforms for big tech, calling Facebook, Amazon, and Apple all monopolies, and describing how Google neutralized its search rivals. We will break down what it all means. Plus, Facebook and Twitter take action on a post from the president in which he claims the flu is more lethal than COVID a day after he is discharged from the hospital. And with the election less than a month away, wildfires continue to ravage the West Coast and the future of office work in question. What's happening in the real estate market? Is it the end of the city as we know it? But first, let's take a look at the markets. U.S. stocks tumbling after President Trump said he is ending stimulus talks until after the election. This was just hours after Fed Chair Jay Powell renewed his warning that the economy will stumble without additional fiscal support. I want to bring in Bloomberg's Abigail Doolittle. Abigail, also, we're seeing big tech falling a bit more than the broader market on the back of this report from the House. Walk us through the day.
Well, once again, a topsy-turvy day, Emily. And before President Trump tweeting right around 2:50 p.m. about wanting to end that stimulus negotiation, it was a jittery day. And a piece of that was big tech. Right out of the gate, we had big tech weakness. But ahead of President Trump tweeting, we actually had the S&P 500 up 0.6%. So investors working past those jitters. And then President Trump coming out, signaling that he wants to stop stimulus talks with the Democrats. And there you see it, the S&P 500 simply dropping. So a 2% intraday move, bearish to the downside, more uncertainty introduced. Although, Emily, for the S&P 500 to finish down 1.4%, and if you include the total move on the day, down 2%, traders and investors really thought that this was the end to the stimulus negotiations, you might have seen more of a sell-off. So this may suggest more uncertainty and that there could be more negotiating tactics ahead. But you were mentioning that NASDAQ 100 down sharply, really confirmed by the fact that the VIX on the NASDAQ 100 spiking. So there's that volatility really in play. The dollar and the bonds, the 10-year yield, down by about 5 basis points. So we have a bit of a haven bid. So a true risk-off day. Started jittery, uncertain, turned truly risk-off. And then really at the end of the day, after the close, those headlines you were talking about, a House panel wanting to potentially break up some of the big tech companies. So the big laggards on the day down a little bit more in after-hours trading, including Apple, Amazon, Alphabet, and Facebook, with that report saying companies that were once scrappy underdog startups that challenged the status quo are now monopolies similar to railroads in the last century. It's going to be interesting to see. We've been following similar stories, this storyline, Emily, for a couple of years. It seems, though, that maybe we've gone from the shot across the bow to having to take all of this a bit more seriously, but probably still not a 2020 event, Emily, based on the action that we're seeing for these stocks, understanding that there's big declines there.
All right, Abigail Doolittle, thanks for walking us through that. Lots to get through. A House panel, as Abigail said, proposed a sweeping series of antitrust reforms to curb the power of big tech, including Amazon, Apple, Google, and Facebook. This is the result of a year-long antitrust investigation that found the companies are abusing their dominance. For more, I want to bring in Bloomberg Tech's Sarah Friar. And Sarah, this is a 449-page report, so a lot to go through, but the most dramatic proposal to overhaul competition law in decades. What are the most dramatic recommendations here that you're pulling out?
Well, so far we've seen that the companies could be restricted from owning different business lines or could even have certain organizational structures imposed upon them. And that would be just a tremendous change to how these companies operate. We've heard calls to break them up. We've heard calls to rein in their power. I think that this is something that is, they're very serious about it, that this is going to have to be approved, of course, by Congress. The proposal will still need to move forward that way. But this is a huge investment by the government in reining in the power of these companies.
Absolutely. And I should add that this House panel is led by Democrats. It's going to be an uphill battle to get Republicans to buy into this. They've notoriously and historically been skeptical of antitrust law. But the report doesn't hold back. A quote from the report: companies that were once scrappy underdog startups that challenged the status quo have become the kinds of monopolies we last saw in the era of oil barons and railroad tycoons. These firms have too much power, and that power must be reined in and subject to appropriate oversight and enforcement. Our economy and democracy are at stake. So the big question is this going to lead to a breakup of big tech? Is that what the House is recommending here?
Well, I think that that is also the worst fear from the companies. That we've seen Facebook already come out and say breaking them up would be near impossible. I mean, the biggest argument in favor of breaking up, as outlined in the report, is that they really feel that the quality that consumers are getting from these products has been degraded because of their power. So in many cases, these are free products, so existing antitrust law doesn't necessarily apply, which is why these sweeping reforms would be necessary to think about their costs to consumers in a different way.
Now, Amazon out with a statement in reaction to this, saying fringe notions on antitrust would destroy small businesses and hurt consumers. Misguided interventions in the free market would kill off independent retailers and punish consumers by forcing small businesses out of popular online stores, raising prices and reducing consumer choice and convenience. Might want to challenge the word fringe there, given that this is the result of a year-long investigation by a House committee that is comprised of both Republicans and Democrats. But we've also heard from Facebook leading up to this that a breakup of Facebook is a non-starter. What kinds of response are you expecting from the companies, especially Facebook, about this?
Well, first of all, that's just such a classic line. You get that from Facebook, Amazon, Apple, Google, whenever they're asked about their power, they always bring it back to the small businesses because these are platform companies. Businesses are being built on top of them. If you're an Amazon seller, if you're building, if you're an Instagram influencer, if you are a developer using Apple's App Store, they always bring it back to that. So I would be very skeptical of that argument because it shows that these companies do have so much power over the economy. Small business is the economy and that's what they're using. I think in the case of Facebook, you know, I was really interested in some of the rebuttals of Facebook's arguments. Facebook has said openly that they feel that Instagram, for instance, would never be able to grow to the size and power it is today without Instagram, without Facebook's involvement and investment. In this report, they have actually obtained the growth projections from Instagram, whether or not they would be acquired, and found that they are relatively the same. Instagram did have the resources to grow independently without Facebook. They didn't necessarily need Facebook in order to survive. So they're refuting that argument. Also in the Facebook side, they say that the company is competing more with apps internally. Facebook is competing more with Instagram and WhatsApp, which they own, than they are with Twitter and Snapchat. And they use that as an indicator of their monopoly status.
Now, meantime, Facebook and Twitter today have been embroiled in another controversy, another controversial tweet by the president. This time, Facebook deleted the tweet. Twitter put it behind a warning. And in this tweet, the president claiming that COVID is less lethal than the seasonal flu. He's also been on quite a roll, tweeting a lot in the last 24 hours amid questions about his mental state while he's on these multiple drugs as a result of his COVID-19 diagnosis. What is your reaction to the way the companies handled this, and how is the president's behavior any different from normal?
Well, the fact that we're talking about it at all shows how new this experiment is to play whack-a-mole with the president's words. I mean, this is the kind of thing that Twitter and Facebook have said they don't want. They don't want misinformation that could lead to direct harm. But where you draw that line is really difficult. So yesterday, for instance, the Trump tweet said that he thought that you shouldn't be afraid of COVID. You shouldn't let it rule your life. That was considered to be safe enough. But this this message, comparing it to the flu, was considered dangerous. So I think that the closer the president gets to a fact versus an opinion, the easier it is for the networks to justify taking some action on that information. But it's not consistent and it's not immediate.
All right. Well, we'll stay tuned for more posts by the president, Sarah Friar, who covers big tech for us. Thank you so much, Sarah, for your analysis there. Coming up, with tech employees fleeing Silicon Valley, wildfires battering the West Coast, and an election that could throw us into even further chaos. Where does that leave the housing market? We're going to hear from Glenn Kelman, the CEO of Redfin, who also has some thoughts on big tech antitrust scrutiny. Next. This is Bloomberg. A House panel has finally released the results of its year-long investigation into big tech, proposing the most sweeping reforms to big tech law in history. This is a 449-page report. It calls Facebook, Amazon, and Apple monopolies. It says Google has neutralized its search rivals. Joining me now is the CEO of Redfin, a real estate tech company that depends on Google and Apple for customers and traffic. Glenn, thank you so much for joining us. I got to ask for your reaction here. The House calling three out of four of these companies a monopoly and recommending laws that could lead to the breakup of these companies. What is your reaction?
Well, regardless of whether these laws come to pass, all of the tech giants will take note and it will dampen some of their extreme competitive efforts, which is good news for every company our size. We worry all the time about getting pushed down in Google results. We want to make sure that we're treated fairly in the App Store. And I think those companies are going to think twice about taking any kind of action that balances the market in their favor.
Just how much do you depend on Google and Apple for customers?
Google? A lot. A lot. We get about half our customers from Google. Apple, less so. I mean, obviously, both provide amazing platform technologies, but Google is the most important partner we have.
So speaking from the perspective of a developer, obviously, you know, I use the Redfin app probably more than I should. But what is your perspective? We've heard a lot of developers say, look, this is not fair. They're charging us way too much. And other developers saying that's just the cost of doing business. Apple and Google should be able to charge us rent for the service that they provide.
Well, we aren't paying anything for Apple's App Store placement. We don't charge you to use the Redfin app, and Apple isn't getting a piece of that. So we can't complain. It's an amazing platform. Apple's an amazing partner. Obviously, if you're trying to monetize that traffic directly through the store and having payments that Apple takes a piece of, that is a totally different story. As for Google, we pay Google to appear. We also appear for free. That is the way the economy has been structured for a long time. And we just want to make sure that there's competition, that Bing and Google keep duking it out because they keep each other honest. If there were only one search provider and there were more advertised placements at the top of every search result, it would just make it harder and harder, especially for a new company, one smaller than Redfin, to beat our ass. And we don't want that. We want a wide open marketplace where the best real estate search technology wins. So I think it's really important just to keep it that way. You don't want to make this about capital. You want to make it about technology and the best consumer experience.
So speaking from the perspective of an entrepreneur who has built a company from scratch, do you think these companies are stifling innovation? I mean, is it possible for the next Redfin to stand a chance, given how these companies operate in that they own the marketplace, but also compete on the marketplace?
Well, I don't think you can blame Apple and Google for it. Just in general, incumbency on the internet has become much more valuable than it was 15 years ago. It used to be that a $1 billion company competing against a $5 million company didn't have a huge advantage because the $5 million company could build a better mousetrap. But now, if you have been in Google's index for a long time, if you have a huge marketing budget, if you have all these network effects, the chances that an upstart is going to take you on are much lower. And so I love the wild days of the internet back in 1999 and even 2005, when anyone who built a better site could get more traffic and build a great business. And I think that is slowly decaying over time. It is not Google's fault. It is not Apple's fault. It is just the nature of industries as they mature.
So we'll talk about real estate in a second, but I do just have one more question then. Do you believe that there should be laws passed?
These are our biggest partners. What?
Do you think these companies should be broken up?
Well, first of all, I'm not a legislator, so who is it for me to say? I'm also not the CEO of any of those companies. I try not to comment on businesses outside of our own. I think that it's important that these businesses accept boundaries, that untrammeled corporate power, whether I have it or anyone else does, is a threat to social well-being. So I think there are limits short of a breakup that can be effective, and that you use talk of a breakup to impose other types of limits on what kinds of companies you can buy, on what kinds of products you can promote on your own site. Without that hammer, I think some of the smaller regulatory efforts aren't going to be as effective. So I think the government's talking about it, but unlikely to actually break up these companies. And Microsoft shows us that just that conversation can be so deadly to the buccaneering culture of a Facebook and Amazon and Google. They have to spend more time thinking about their impact on society and less time thinking about how to conquer the world. Maybe that's good.
So appreciate you. Yes, yes. Appreciate you being game to take a swing at that. Let's talk about real estate. We've been debating the future of the market, given all of the uncertainty in the world. I've heard it's the end of cities. I've heard the end of the city is a myth. What exactly are you seeing in the real estate market, and where are we going?
Well, I just think it's a rebalancing. Cities are taking a step back. Rural and suburban areas are taking a step forward. You can't have this incredible concentration of wealth that happened over the past 20 years in San Francisco, New York, and Seattle go on forever. At some point, we've got to share the love. So the fact that rich people are moving all over the country to Wyoming and Texas and everywhere in between is a good thing for us politically and economically. It means that everything great about Silicon Valley is going to happen elsewhere. But it also means that home prices in rural places are shooting through the roof, that anyone in the business of helping someone move from there to here is in a very good position right now. So I think America is just going through a significant shift, but it doesn't mean that New York is dead or San Francisco is dead. Those are still some of the greatest cities in the world, and everyone's going to want to live there sooner or later.
I mean, I have to ask you about the political landscape. I mean, we've got a huge election now in less than a month. Do you, and we've seen plenty of surprises in the last couple of weeks. I'm sure there will be more. Do you think that there is some certainty ahead about which way the market will go? Or could the election throw us into more turmoil?
I think there's a significant chance the election will throw us into more turmoil. The reason that so many companies are raising money right now, trying to either get convertible notes done or an IPO done, is because nobody wants to bet on November and December. But we should also take into account how the economy is affecting the election. The fact that 300,000 people in the past 4 years moved from California to Arizona accounts for about half of the lead that Biden has over Trump in Arizona. The same thing is happening from California to Texas. One of the reasons that state is going purple isn't because anyone who was already there changed his mind. It's in part because people have changed their address. So the economy is changing society. Society's going to change the economy.
That said, you've got so many people who are really suffering right now. You've called this an unequal recession because some people are feeling this worse than others. The housing market for white Americans is different than it is for Black Americans. What are the trends that you're seeing?
Well, I think with this particular recession, we've finally seen the American economy completely split in two. So there is one part of the economy that is hurting in the most awful way. The retail segment, the service segment is in dire shape. But at the same time, it is just a bonanza for the upper class because very cheap credit, very good stock market, low housing prices in much of America. So those folks are going hog wild. And anyone who sits across that straddle, as I do, can't help but feel uncomfortable about it. This isn't the way Redfin wanted to prosper. We want to see the whole economy do well, not just the economy for one half of America.
All right. Glenn Kelman, CEO of Redfin. Can always count on you, Glenn, to give it to us straight. Thank you so much for joining us today. Continuing now on that big tech antitrust report that has dropped from the House Antitrust Subcommittee, Apple dominating the news. We mentioned the finding of the panel that Apple has a monopoly over app developers. This also happens to be the day that Apple said it will hold an event next week to unveil something. We believe it's new 5G iPhones. Bloomberg's Mark Gurman with us now. Mark, let's start on the antitrust report. What is your take? Obviously, the findings are incredibly dramatic. You've got Democrats now having to convince Republican lawmakers to get them on their side. But what is your take on the House recommendations here?
I mean, these were all expected recommendations, right? They're talking about, I mean, if we're looking at Apple specifically, the idea of not competing with apps on the App Store for different categories that Apple has an app in or plans to make an app in. The committee said that the App Store cut of 30% is very high, says it gives its own apps priority in the App Store. It gave examples of Apple rejecting applications only to sort of copy that feature into its own app. The committee went as far as quoting Steve Jobs, a quote that he said several years ago, saying that we've always been shameless about stealing great ideas. So very much some sharp rhetoric against Apple here in the report. However, there's not much in here that we haven't heard before. None of the recommendations particularly go right at Apple in terms of changes for Apple. The recommendations are for across those big four tech cos, Google, Apple, Amazon, and Facebook. And like you said, this is going to have to get to a point where these recommendations are approved and enacted into laws. But I think that's going to take quite a bit of time, and you'll probably see tech companies change some of their practices or at least shift a little bit to avoid being hit by those down the road.
We are we haven't heard yet from Apple on this, but I'm expecting and awaiting a statement, Mark. Let's talk about the event next week. The invitations went out this morning. You all along had reported that the phones would be delayed until October. So what do you expect will be unveiled next week?
Yeah, so as the invitation implies, as they say, high speed, and I think Apple should work on their little taglines for the invites, if I'm being honest, but that's implying that 5G is going to be at the star of the show, so 5G iPhones. And the interesting thing is that this is going to be the thing that they're marketing the iPhone on, 5G, but at the end of the day, 5G penetration across the U.S. is extraordinarily limited. So what you're going to end up doing is you're going to see lots of people buy these new iPhones in the weeks and months following the announcement. They're going to turn it on, and they're going to start complaining about how 5G doesn't work in their area. So I think that's going to be something to look out for.
So let's talk about the 5G part of this. How significant quickly is that?
I mean, 5G speeds are incredibly fast. They could be up to 5 to 10 times faster than your home Wi-Fi network. You can download apps in the pinch of a second. And, you know, people believe it's going to enable augmented reality. But it's going to be a while till we see the full effect of 5G connection.
All right. Bloomberg's Mark Gurman, thank you so much for your reporting there. Again, we will be following that event, Apple's event, coming up next week, October 13th. And I just want to reiterate the headlines coming out of that House report, a 449-page report recommending the most dramatic proposal to overhaul competition law in decades. The House panel has been investigating big tech now for a full year, calling Apple, Amazon, and Facebook monopolies, saying that Google has neutralized its search rivals. We're going to continue to bring you the headlines from this report. It's quite dense, so a lot to go through, but a big drop today from the House Antitrust Subcommittee. Coming up, we'll have more of Bloomberg Technology after this quick break. Welcome back to Bloomberg Technology. I'm Emily Chang in San Francisco. We have learned that the U.S. Labor Department is investigating whether Microsoft's pledge to promote more black managers and executives violates civil rights law. Microsoft says it's confident the initiatives are legal. With us now is Bloomberg's Dina Bass, who has covered Microsoft for decades. Dina, is the Labor Department calling this reverse discrimination?
Well, that's not the term they're using, but, you know, Microsoft, but it essentially amounts to what the conventional use of that term, I think. You know, people at Microsoft told us that last week they got a letter from the Labor Department's Office of Federal Contract Compliance Programs, and that letter asked about a program that Microsoft announced in June that pledged to double the number of executives and managers who are black or African-American in the next 5 years. And the question was from the department was whether this, you know, Microsoft said in a blog post today, whether the diversity initiative, quote, appears to imply that the employment action may be taken on the basis of race. That was what the letter from the Labor Department said to Microsoft. And the department asked Microsoft to respond to that question, and Microsoft is now responding and is saying that they are certain that their program meets federal law and is both fair and legal.
Now, Microsoft's pledge was quite dramatic, but we've actually heard from a number of different companies pledges to increase the black representation, especially in leadership ranks. Airbnb comes to mind. I'm not positive whether the wording and the specifics are exactly in line with Microsoft's, but this could have pretty dramatic implications for companies and corporations that have vowed to have been, you know, I suppose, trying to do the right thing to improve racial diversity.
Yeah, and we're trying to figure out right now whether other companies have received the same letter. I think the companies at the kind of cross-section here would be companies who, as you mentioned, made specific diversity pledges to increase representation and who are also government contractors. And so, you know, there are companies like Boeing and companies like Google, who are U.S. government contractors, have programs that are in some way similar to the Microsoft ones. Google said they want to have 30% more leaders from, quote, underrepresented groups by 2025. Boeing says it's targeting increasing representation rate of black employees by 20%. And so there are, Microsoft does not stand alone as company among companies that have both these diversity programs that have been announced recently and are large government contractors. The unusual thing here is that this is an office that has historically gone in the opposite direction. It's historically been involved in making sure that U.S. government contractors do take actions to promote diversity. And this does seem to be a bit of a reversal on that.
Now, I'm really curious for your perspective on these House recommendations recommending a dramatic overhaul to competition law, specifically with regards to Apple, Facebook, Amazon, and Google. You've obviously covered Microsoft for a long time. Microsoft faced antitrust scrutiny back in the day. You've covered the fallout from that, and Microsoft has now come out and said, for example, it thinks some of Apple's practices are unfair. What does this scrutiny on Microsoft's rivals mean for Microsoft?
Well, I think for now, Microsoft is probably happy that they're not in that list. And as you mentioned, they have themselves complained, you know, back in the spring about Apple's actions with regards to the App Store. Microsoft's particular complaint largely comes from the fact that its Xbox video game service has had difficulties being on the App Store, complying with Apple's App Store rules. And so Microsoft has been unhappy with that and has been trying to work it out. In the meantime, their Xbox video game streaming service is not currently available on iOS, where it did launch in September on Android. And so Microsoft is hoping that some of this scrutiny might change Apple's behavior. In terms of the other companies, certainly, you know, Google and Amazon are, you know, Microsoft's biggest competitors in the cloud space. So there is that. At the same time, you know, Microsoft, I think, has a healthy attitude of, you know, there but for the grace of God go I. They know that antitrust can really hurt a company. They've been there before. And so, they also may be wary of whether there's, you know, anything that might, you know, continue to expand in any sort of probe that could potentially touch them, or just, you know, in general, a more aggressive antitrust regime.
Interesting. Fascinating, Dina, to hear your perspective, given all the years that you've covered the company. So thank you so much for that. Bloomberg's Dina Bass out of Washington. Now, in the face of COVID-19 and climate change, cities are turning to smart infrastructure and mobility to make urban centers more green and resilient. Jay Walder has run some of the world's largest infrastructure projects and is now leading the development of the revolutionary Hyperloop transportation system. He joined Bloomberg's New Economy Forum today via a virtual panel called Building Back Greener.
We're kidding ourselves if we think the answer to the situation that we're in right now is just going back and getting back to all the things that we were doing before. We had a tremendous need to be able to have new forms of transportation. I think the discussion about the new flying planes is a part of that. But it's across all spectrum in being able to do this. The fact of the matter is that we have 21st century problems today. We want to be able to have a transportation system that works for us in the way that we want it to be. We want it to be not just fast, we want it to be on demand. We want it to be the way that we live our life. We wanted to reflect our values, and I think the environment is a very big part of the values that we have today. So having technology for technology's sake is not the point. It's really about reshaping the thinking, creating something that allows us to have mass transportation in a way that fits for the needs that we have. My shorthand for this is to imagine, as you point out, connecting cities like metro stops. And what would that mean? And now all of a sudden we're moving beyond the question of sprawl and we're redefining urban environments and connecting urban environments and thinking about how we have mobility across urban environments for the things that matter to us, for education, for labor mobility, for culture, for healthcare, et cetera. And it's no longer about having disconnected places. It's about having places that feel as if they really are the same environment. This is groundbreaking for us.
So if this works out for you, you're going to put airlines out of business, at least on the shorter hops. How green are you compared with the airlines?
In total, we'll be about one-tenth the emissions of a short-haul plane. So it certainly fits in fitting with our vision of what we want to do in regard to the environment. Look, I don't think short-haul flights are in the long-term plans of airlines. I think what airlines have invested in for short-haul flights is to be able to connect people to hubs for longer haul flights. The idea that we're reimagining how different parts of the transportation paradigm are served shouldn't surprise anybody. There's nothing wrong with that in thinking about it.
Do you also replace gas-guzzling cars and trucks?
Absolutely. So look, here's one of my favorite stories. I stood in Columbus, Ohio, and I asked people in Columbus, Ohio, I said, how far is it from here to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania? And everybody gave me the same answer. They said it was 3 hours. And look, I'm a kid from Queens. What do I know about how far it is? But I looked at everybody and I said, you're wrong. And they're surprised. And I said, the correct answer to that question is that it's 185 miles. Pittsburgh and Columbus will always be 185 miles apart. But what you did was you translated distance to time on the basis of 1956 technology. That's called the interstate highway system. It's called getting in your car to be able to do this. In my book, that trip, it's still 185 miles, but it's 25 minutes. And I think when you begin to think of it that way, when you begin to say that's the amount of time when it goes when you want to go, so you avoid the tyranny of train schedules, when it goes to the city center and when you have connective links to be able to get to the places you want to go, I wouldn't get in a car, would you?
Jay Walder, the CEO of Virgin Hyperloop, speaking with Andy Brown, our Bloomberg New Economy editorial director. All right, coming up, mobile payment app Venmo is now competing with Apple in credit card territory. We're going to talk to an investor in Venmo next. This is Bloomberg. Venture capital firm Greycroft says today it has raised nearly $680 million to find the next Bumble or Venmo, topping the previous $250 million fund they raised in 2017 and 2018. This is private companies are becoming more expensive to invest in, partly because of strong market values of comparable public tech companies. Joining us now for more, Greycroft co-founder and partner Ian Sigalow. Ian, thank you so much for joining us. So talk to us about how the investing landscape has changed since 2017 and 2018. Obviously, things have gotten a lot more expensive. You have companies waiting a lot longer to go public. How does that change the strategy?
So I think in the past 2 years, what we've seen is a great public market for our late stage companies. And at Greycroft, we've had two IPOs. We had ICA in Hong Kong earlier this year and The RealReal last year. And that's, I guess, across the entire industry. Most VCs have had a handful of IPOs now, and the IPO markets are open. That helps with liquidity for us. It also helps with M&A down the road for our companies that then sell to those public companies. So investors in the asset class are getting a lot of liquidity, and we're seeing good multiples in the public market.
So let's talk about that, because we've been breaking down this report from the U.S. House on big tech recommending breakup of these big companies. Do you, as an investor, think that Apple, Google, Facebook, Amazon, are they monopolies and stifling innovation?
Well, in some ways, yes. In other ways, no. As a technology investor, we look for businesses that are what we call natural monopolies, have network effects. So if you take Google's core search engine and that business by itself, for instance, there are network effects in that business. If you split that up, it would go back to a world where there'd be one dominant search engine. However, the anti-competitive piece is the bundling of other apps along with core search, like YouTube plus search, where Google drives traffic to its owned and operated sites. And I do think that's anti-competitive behavior.
So what should be done? Should they be broken up?
It's tricky. Ultimately, if the government comes in and breaks up Google into multiple business units, in a way, Alphabet already is a collection of multiple businesses. I guess you could spin it off and they do commercial deals. I guess that's one path forward. Reading through what the House has suggested, however, it was far beyond that. And it included things like prohibiting Amazon from selling manufactured products on its own marketplace. And I think, the question is, where do you draw the line, Emily? Because, Walmart has been selling owned goods for decades. And are we going to prohibit retailers from selling products they manufacture if we think that's anti-competitive?
So talking about one of your former portfolio companies, which is Venmo, launching a credit card to compete with Goldman's Apple Card, you know, some of the concerns about Apple have been around its payments product. You know, what is your take on this development and whether Venmo can and should compete with Apple?
So Venmo was an amazing business. We invested, you know, probably 8.5 years ago now. And then we sold it to Braintree, and then we invested in Braintree, and then PayPal, which at the time was owned by eBay, bought the combined company for $800 million. You know, back then, Venmo was still relatively small, you know, millions of monthly actives. It's now 60 million monthly actives. Venmo was really the first mobile fintech app, mobile consumer fintech app. And for now, the better part of 5 or 6 years, very little has happened to Venmo. You know, they've just tried to scale it. And scaling it has been hard enough because 60 million monthly actives requires a lot of work and fraud prevention and detection. But if you look across the venture landscape, you know, we're in Acorns and we're in Public, and there's nouveau banks like Chime out there. And those companies exist in part because Venmo hasn't added those features to its core platform. And now PayPal is going to invest more in consumer fintech to catch up with Apple. And we'll see if they're successful. You know, I use Venmo every week, but I use it for payments. I don't use it for checking out at a local retailer. And I just think that behavior change is probably outside the scope of what most Venmo users will regularly do with a product.
Really interesting perspective there, and we'll be watching as you look for the next Venmo and Bumble. Graycroft co-founder and partner Ian Sigalo, thank you so much for joining us. Still ahead, an overview of the House panel's new proposal for big tech antitrust reforms, including Facebook, Amazon, Apple, Google. That is next. This is Bloomberg. Back now to our top story of the hour. After a 16-month investigation, a House panel has issued proposals of far-reaching antitrust reforms to curb the power of U.S. tech giants. Those include Amazon, Apple, Facebook, and Google. Joining us now for more, our Bloomberg Tech Senior Executive Editor, Brad Stone. Brad, you've been covering tech and big tech for a long time. What are your broad takeaways here?
Yeah, well, it's quite a report. I mean, it's as much a prescription of remedies and the list of harms as it is a kind of call to action. The committee is urging Congress to kind of revive the great antitrust tradition of oversight, you know, hearkening back to the days of Ma Bell and the railroad tycoons, the oil barons, Microsoft. You know, it's thorough, 448 pages. I have not read the whole thing. I'm sure a few people have. And it's fairly damning. You know, it shows how Amazon, Apple, Facebook, and Google engaged in anti-competitive, you know, monopoly-style tactics. I think one of the more effective things the report does is it draws lines of connections between the companies. So you see how they misappropriated data on their platforms. You know, Google and Apple do it by tracking usage trends and growth patterns on third-party apps and then releasing their own. Amazon does it by tracking what sells and producing white label products. You know, Facebook looks at its platform, identifies what's growing fast, and makes acquisitions. So, you know, these companies are going to have their hands full responding to this very comprehensive report.
Amazon published a blog post in response to the report calling misguided interventions in the free market, saying they would kill off independent retailers and punish consumers. You've written a book about Amazon. You're writing another book about Amazon. You know, the big contention is Amazon selling its own products on its own marketplace. If that is disrupted, how far-reaching would the implications be?
Right. It's a bit more than that with respect to Amazon. I think the most effective parts of the report pertaining to Amazon is really kind of describing how the company engages in what the report calls bullying. So, you know, that's suspending sellers without notice, requiring them to advertise, forcing them into most favored nation relationships, which prevents them from lowering prices on other platforms. Now, the report addressed things like Alexa and AWS sort of unpersuasively, I thought. But when it comes to the sellers, Amazon disputes this, but I think they have to realize that the chorus of voices is loud now, and sellers feel like they're in a vice. And, you know, the blog post, I think, is Amazon's first crack at responding to this thing. It says that their interests are aligned with sellers, but the facts are the facts, and a lot of sellers are complaining about Amazon's conduct.
What kind of chain reaction is this going to kick off? I mean, obviously, Democrats need to try to get Republicans on side. This will be certainly a long congressional process. But what's next?
Well, I think this is really the starter pistol, right? It's the beginning of the race. The Justice Department's about to file an antitrust complaint against Google. The Justice Department and the FTC are also looking at Amazon, Apple, and Facebook. You have everything going on in Europe. You know, a lot's going to hinge on the next election. I think when it comes to remedies, you know, they talked a little bit about structural separation of the companies. That's a hard road. It's very kind of politically, you know, sensitive. Not a lot of Republicans agree with that. So I think it's the beginning. But, you know, I think we can officially declare that the age of these companies kind of skating by in Washington with this report is now over.
So last quick question. Obviously, these companies have incredible resources. How do you expect them to fight back?
Yeah, well, actually, it's one of the things that the report talks about, which is, you know, these companies are growing in Washington, D.C., that agencies have often been kind of outgunned. You know, the companies will fight back by doing what they do, you know, hiring lobbyists and arguing their cases strenuously with lawmakers. And one of the things that this report calls for, I think one of the more practical suggestions is for Congress to, you know, amplify funding to antitrust agencies and to basically re-embrace its historic role as kind of an antitrust watchdog.
All right. Brad Stone, our senior executive editor for Bloomberg Technology, thank you so much for your insight there. Of course, we're going to continue to cover this, what it means for the tech industry. That does it for this edition of Bloomberg Technology. We're on Bloomberg Television, an interview with former New York mayor and President Trump's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani. That will be tomorrow, an exclusive interview, 8:30 a.m. Eastern Time. You don't want to miss it. This is Bloomberg.